if you said that the Big Bang was essentially a sort of a crystallization of a condensation of particles that came out of this field, and the energy in the field condensed, I suppose that that is pre-Big Bang. That then leads to the next question: how many theorists as to where that field came from?
So the question is where did the impetus come from, essentially? So, who knows, really? The fact that it is when you teach undergraduate particle physics that you start off with a theory which is essentially this theory of inflation. It's the simplest particle theory that you could write down. So it's very natural from the point of view of particle physics that the universe should have one of these fields in it. But why and where the fields came from? And it's part of a much bigger question, which is why there should be anything at all. Why the equations that were, why anything? And physics, I don't think we're going to be able to answer that at all. All it does is push it back. It just means that, we say, look how far how much we can explain. And then say, where did it all happen from? And so that's what always be, I don't know. It certainly is possible. This theory, the multiverse thing, is often referred to as a theory of eternal inflation. So it's quite possible that inflation has just been going on forever, which kind of ducks the question of what started it. But in a sense, it is an answer. Some people feel quite satisfied with that as an answer. The universe has always been. It's a bit of a thorny one from the point of view of cause. Whether you regard that as a satisfactory answer to the, or whether, yeah. So I think questions for ultimate origin are not going to be answered anytime soon. But there's nothing steady state about this. So I can see where you're coming from, right? So the theory of the inflated universe with these kind of bubble universes popping out of nowhere. I mean, that's very reminiscent of what you would steady state. So you wanted an eternal universe, So that's in a sense, there are some similarities, yeah. We should remember in this case, though, I mean, the scales are all different. I mean, it's totally, and these bubbles are moving apart at a ferocious rate. So we've got a background of very rapid expansion, which is far, so it's far from steady state, right, in that sense. Well, it's true that I think some people, was it a chemist in Canada or something, was worrying that the mini black holes that might be produced at the LHC would destroy the Earth. And, CERN took that, it was already, that idea that mini black holes might get produced at the LHC is something that was appreciated already, and it had been long discussed. But CERN actually, just to really calm everybody's nerves, actually made a report on that specifically to demonstrate that under no circumstances is it possible to destroy the Earth using the LHC, using any kind of known physics. So you might say, well, what about unknown physics? How about unknown physics might mean that when you press your card button, when the card today, the entire universe explodes. In other words, you can make anything up. It's quite highly real. The energies involved at the LHC are a small fraction of the power supply of Geneva. It's like, what do you think is going to happen, right? It's like, it is a bit like turning a light bulb on and expecting the universe to explode. There's nothing that remarkable about what happens in particle physics experiments. Just a handful of particles colliding. In your imagination, you are free to do what you want with your imagination. And that's using your imagination, and that's often very good for physics. But it has to be harnessed and brought under the control of, like, of reason, because it is entirely possible. That, I mean, that the idea that somebody makes something up and then takes the thing they just made up seriously, without anything to support it, any framework, logical or experimental. I mean, that's just the route to madness, I think. And, I've not been too.
Do the current theories satisfactorily explain the way that the redshift of the first separated galaxies is greatest at the time that they're moving almost extremely light apart? Do these theories explain that satisfactorily?
Yes. Yeah. So they can be moving apart actually faster than the speed of light. So galaxies, the most distant galaxies on this side and the most distant galaxies on this side can be moving apart as observed from the Earth at faster than the speed of light. But if you're on that galaxy over there, that doesn't mean that that galaxy over there is receding from you at faster than the speed of light. Right. It doesn't follow that that's the case. So it's further complicated by the fact that during inflation, all the dots are essentially moving apart superluminally. So, but it's, I mean, the statement of Einstein that things can't travel faster than the speed of light, that's an inaccurate statement. What really is meant by that is that information cannot be transmitted at speeds faster than the speed of light, which is a slightly different statement. Things are moving further. But in the very long term future, so this dark energy that we have, it seems to indicate that the universe will expand ever so slightly faster tomorrow than it was doing today. And that will continue. But if that continues, there will become a time when essentially everything is expanded, moved away from us so far that even light emitted from the most distant thing can't reach us anymore because the distant thing is moving away from us faster than the speed of light. Then we'll never see anything. So in the very distant future, but now we're talking, like, this is all, this, I think, I don't know how many orders of magnitude bigger than a trillion years, right? But we're talking very, very distant future. It will be the case that there won't be any galaxies to see in the sky. So the universe will be stretched out so far that those distant things will be too far away for even light to reach us. So if you see that happens, it's like, because if they're moving away from us quicker than light, than the speed of light, and the light emitted from them will never reach us. And if space is expanding faster and faster and faster, that will eventually be the case, that everything is moving away from us faster than the speed of light. So kind of cosmology becomes very boring.
Do you explain how galaxies
could they be doing what? I missed the first part. Could they be
all the galaxies
are moving apart
from each other, except gravity driving Andromeda
comes towards us. Okay.
Could the same happen to multiverse?
Well, the scales are, I mean, in principle it's possible that there could be some gravitational effect on a nearby multiverse, a nearby pocket, one of these. But typically, any two of these is kind of mind-bogglingly far away, moving at such rapid speeds away from us that any kind of local gravitational effect will just be totally swamped out.
So,
so you're right. So if this is infinitely big, so what I said typically I think this is the case. But you're right. When things are infinitely big, weird things can happen. So it is possible that one of these pockets could be right next to ours. But two of them could kind of overlap. You could have this region here stopped inflating just a bit after this one, and they kind of have like a little overlap. And there's some kind of interaction at the boundary. People are looking for that. So in order to ascertain that, you kind of got to look for some kind of an edge to our universe, or some kind of an interaction. Looks like our universe ends and another one, so that kind of thing. Some kind of edges to the universe, or some kind of evidence of the proximity of some nearby one of these. So it's a long shot. but it's the only thing that people have got to go on. So there is some serious research from astronomers, I think at University College in London in particular, who are looking for evidence of multiverse through that. In fact, that's the only piece of evidence, the only searches that I'm aware of. It kind of has to be, really, doesn't it? You kind of look for the fortunate circumstance where one of these is close to you. We'd have to be on the right side of the, because if that circle is the entire visible universe, that's something we'd also have to be on the edge, so that we were close enough to the edge for the circle to come inside of our things that we could see. So we did have to be really lucky, you know. This is vast, we're a tiny spot, we have to be right on the edge of it, and there has to be another one really close. Could be. Worth looking at.
So by the number of hands, I can see that we are have a huge amount of questions, and unfortunately we are out of time. So Jeff has very kindly agreed to give a few minutes at the end to sign some books and also take some questions individually. But if I could ask for you to prioritise young people first during that time, that would be fantastic. So I'd just like to end by saying thank you again for coming this evening, and thank you all for very much for attending. Thank you.